Hello, welcome everybody to this on-demand session for Visual Fox Fest. Today's session is about data binding, and I want to show you how X-based developers can bind their data to Windows Forms and WPF in .NET. Before I start, a few things about myself. I've been in IT for a long, long time, like many of you guys. I started in 84. I've worked with many development languages over the years, but most of them are from the XBase family. Started with DBase, FoxBase, and I gradually moved to the Clipper Visual Objects family, but I've also touched Visual Fox Pro during those years. I've created a couple of third-party products for Visual Objects and Vulkan, and I've also used C++, Assembler, and C# for that. So like many of you, I would call myself a software dinosaur. I've been in this industry for ages. A couple of years ago, I started a new X-based project for .NET called X-Sharp, together with a couple of other developers that I knew from the VO and Vulkan development team. If you want to reach me, my email address is on the slide, and feel free to ask any questions online as well on our website, xsharp.info, or through mail. Okay, what I'm going to show you today is, like the title says, binding data in .NET. And I'm going to bind data to both Windows Forms and WPF. But before I start doing this binding, I want to tell you a little bit about the product that I'm using. All my source code will use X-Sharp, our own product, X-Base for .NET. Some of these examples are in what we call the core dialect. Others are in the Fox Pro dialect, especially when we're going to use DBS and SQL data using SQL exec function, that has to be Fox Pro. There are some syntax differences between the core dialect and what you guys are used in Fox Pro. And I'm mentioning a couple of these on this slide. In the handout, we'll give you more details about these differences. The most prominent one is that we normally use self as a keyword to refer to the current object, where in Fox Pro, you guys use this. Second one is that for assignments, we usually use colon equals and not a single equals. Single equals is allowed, but it is ambiguous. And because of this ambiguity, it's usually better to write colon equals so the compiler knows what to use. But you can still use single equals if you want. The other difference is that we use a colon operator between an object and its properties instead of the dot operator. The dot operator in Fox Pro is kind of overloaded. It can both be used between cursor and a field, between the variable and its properties. We have decided to use a single operator to use for variables and properties. This is the colon. And finally, the class syntax in the code that we've written manually is using the what we call the core class syntax, but defined class and defined like Fox Pro has is also supported. I'm not really that good in defined class and defined, so that's why most of the samples use class and class. Okay, we're going to talk about data binding in .NET. And .NET is not an easy piece of code. It's a really large environment with lots and lots of classes. Classes are grouped in namespaces, and many programs start with using statement to tell the compiler where to look for a class. Otherwise, the compiler has no idea. For example, there could be control classes in different hierarchies. WPF has a control, Windows Forms has a control. By putting a using statement in your source code, you're telling the compiler where to look for, and then it can resolve the types. Apart from types, we have interfaces, abstract classes, delegates, generic classes, etc. I'm not going to describe all of that in this session. I will describe what I'm using. So, but if you have a question, ask. I will pause a few times during the session so you have a chance to ask your questions. Okay, I'm going to stop with the PowerPoint for now. I'm going to go to source code because I think it's much more interesting to show you the stuff in the source code. Let's switch off the video and go to the source. Okay, Right now, I'm in Visual Studio. X-Sharp, as a development language, supports Visual Studio integration. So what we see here is a solution that you also find in the examples where I'm showing you various kinds of data binding. Let's start with something simple. I have a form, and this form I want to show you from a certain object, first name, last name, and the full name. When you talk about data binding in .NET, you have to bind against something. Now, binding to a DBF is possible. I'll show that in a few samples later. But let's start with what's most common in .NET, and that's that you bind data to a collection of objects. And I want to use this form to bind to a simple object that has two properties and a calculated property. Let's have a look at this object, which is in my sample data project. Over here, you see the source code for a customer class. This uses, like I mentioned before, the syntax that's what we call the core class syntax, and it declares a property as a string and a first name and a full name property, which returns first name plus space plus last name. Fairly simple class. I have a second class which inherits from list of customer. List is what we call a generic class, and this returns objects that are all customer objects. And in this particular constructor, this is like the init method, I'm adding customer objects and I'm assigning first names and last names to each of these objects. So in our code, we can use this customers class and then have a list of customers. Let's look at this form. On the form, apart from the first name, last name, and full name, we see also on the top a control which is called a binding navigator. And we see a non-visual control on the bottom, which is called binding source. To do data binding in Windows Forms, you always need a binding source. The binding source glues the controls of your forms to the data. In this case, the data will be a customer list, but the data could also be data fetched from a SQL environment. Let's have a look at the source code in this form. This class is generated by the Windows Forms editor from Visual Studio, and it always also generates an initialized component. The initialized component is located in the form designer PNG. I'm not touching that because this is generated by Windows Forms, but in this form designer PNG, the variables are declared like the labels, the text boxes, the buttons, etc. What I'm doing here is to bind my form to a customer's collection that I've shown you before, is to create a variable here, a protected variable on this form, a field, and I'm assigning it to customer's collection. So over here we have the customer's collection. Then I'm telling the binding source to set its data source to self-customer. So this actually tells the binding source where to fetch the data from. Then in code, I'm also binding each of the controls that I want to bind to the data source and tell the binding source that its text property must be changed. So whenever I go to a next customer, it needs to assign the text property and it needs to assign the first name property from the object, the current customer. I'm doing the same for the last name and for the full name. So this actually links each of the controls to the binding source. And the binding source then takes care of updating the controls. Let's run this sample. As you see, when I run the sample, it fetches the first object from the collection. And with the binding navigator on top, I can skip through the objects. What I didn't show you is in the designer, I've linked the binding navigator to the binding source. That's necessary because you can have more than one binding source on a form, but in this case, there is only one. Now, when I change this, for example, I call Adam Adams, you see that The full name, which is a calculated property, automatically is adjusted. And some way, the binding source magically detects the change in the last name and automatically refreshes the controls in the of the other one. And we're going to change this one to Donald. And when I close this form, I didn't show you that code, I'm going to build the list of all the full names and show it in the message box. So let's go to the sample. And as you can see, this is a bit small, but it shows Adam Adams, Brett Baker, Chuck Cherry, and Donald Davids. So the objects in this collection have been updated automatically because they were because the binding source take care of that. So the binding source is doing a two-way connection. It connects the controls on the form and feeds them. But if you change something on the form, it sends it back into the objects. And the way to do it is through properties. If you want to do data binding with objects in .NET, you have to make sure that what you expose are properties and not fields. That's what was done in this form. Okay. A second sample, second thing what you often do is have list boxes, combo boxes on the form. And you want to fill those from a data source too. So I'm going to have a look at the next sample where I have a list box and code of this form says I'm going to assign the data source of the list box. You see, again, this has a data source and give it to customers. I'm not using a binding source here because the list box itself is capable of directly supporting a collection. And let's see what happens if I run this. Now, if you run this, you see something that you probably wouldn't expect. You see customer, 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 customer. So the list box shows that it has four customers. There is it's bound to the list, but we don't see what we wanted to see. We don't see the names. So why is that? Well, the reason for that is that you have to tell the list box what to show. And I haven't done that. In the, let's enlarge this window a bit. In the designer, not this. In the designer, we can set the display member. And the display member is not set over here, so it doesn't know what to display. Now, there are two ways to solve this. One way is to create a toString method on the class. The toString method, in this case, returns a string. The default implementation of toString, which we inherit from the object class, returns the name of the class. This is what was called before. So if I change this to return the full name, you will see that the full names are shown. But if you do not want to do that, you can also set the display member to full name over here and get rid of this code. And then you control in the list box what you want to show from the column. The effect is the same, but there are two different ways of doing it. Now, if I select one, and I close the form, it tells me which one I've selected. So binding data to a .NET list box control is done through directly through its data source. The same is true for binding data to a combo box and a couple of other classes that have that. Okay. What if you want to show more than one record, or in terms of FoxPro, what if you want to browse your data? My next sample is going to show you how to browse data. I've created a form now with a grid view. It was called a data grid view. It has a binding navigator, which is this element on the top, which we also see because part of the binding navigator is what we call visual. These are the buttons over here. And the other part is non-visual. And we have a binding source. And I'd like to bind my customers list to this particular grid. So what I can do is I design my grid view here. I've told it how to anchor itself so it properly resizes. And in the code, I'm now using what I've done did before with the form view, basically the painted controls. I'm assigning the customer's object to the data source of the binding source. But now I'm also directly binding the binding source to the grid view. You may wonder if you couldn't have directly used the customer's collection as data source for the grid view. And yes, you could. But then it would be difficult to also synchronize the binding navigator on top. And I think it's nice to have a navigator and see which record you're on and be able to do go top and go bottom with the toolbar buttons. So as you can see now, this actually creates a list over here with all the known names. And we can still change the name, and it actually it's calculated, and the grid view is smart enough to detect that the property full name can only be read, which is a getter, doesn't have an assign, and for that reason the column is read-only. And as you can see on the top, the buttons work. I can, if I want to, I can delete a row. It's actually deleted from the collection. And if you wanted, we could, when we close the form, detect that the collection now has only has less elements because I deleted. If you do a plus, it's going to actually create a new object. You can try to see that too. And as you can see, I have created an object. And this just works as you expect. In the background, the binding source has detected that the customer's collection has a method to add rows. It has called add row, and the customer's collection knows that it's a list of customers and creates a new customer object. Important for that is that the customer object has to have what we call a constructor, an init method, without parameters, because it doesn't know how, which parameters to set in. But if you set that up that way, it just works. Okay. So we've seen binding through a binding source with controls on a form view, and we've seen happening the same with a grid. What if you wanted, in this case, I've used a grid with what we call auto layout. What if you want to control the columns? Well, of course you can. If you go to the designer for the grid view, you can specify columns, and then you can also set the titles of the column. You can set colors, whatever you want. You could have a style here, set a black color to yellow. And if I go to my startup code, I can run this, and you'll see that the binding still happens, but now I've designed the column. And you see the color and the titles just like you expect. So data grid view, it's probably not the same as the FoxPro browser, but it can do a lot. It can do so much that you could spend a whole session on the data grid view. And if you are using .NET and you're not happy with what the data grid view can do, there are many, many third-party grid controls from Telerik, Infragistics, DevExpress that can do much more. And so I think when you move your apps to .NET, giving your customers a browse experience the way you had in FoxPro is absolutely possible, or you can even do it better with all the controls that are available. Okay, now so far we have seen collections of objects, but it is not what you use in FoxPro. In FoxPro, you usually have forms that bind to data. And the next sample that I want to show you does exactly that. And I'm still doing a project in the core dialect. That means that we're not using DBS yet, but this particular one, Forms Customers, is going to actually fetch data through ADO.NET, which is the common .NET data access layer, from a SQL Server database that's running on my own machine. So I've designed a form similar to what we've seen before, and the code behind this form sets up the generated controls, tells it not to generate columns, but and it links the binding source. On the form, you see a load button. Most applications, at least in SQL, do not start with a complete filled grid because the backend may be really large and you want to filter stuff. So usually we have some kind of selection mechanism. It's why the form loads empty and you have to press the load button or a seed button and specify what you're looking for. So that's what I'm emulating. The code behind the load button actually calls a method in the same sample data, which is called getCustomers. And getCustomers, in this case, uses the SQL Server classes from ADO.NET. So I'm opening a connection over here. This begin using statement tells the .NET runtime that we only want to open the connection for the duration of this block. So we're opening connection, and the end using will automatically close the connection. You can also see that I've declared all the variables. In FoxPro, you do not have to do that, but in the core dialect of X-Sharps, declaring variables is a must. By doing that, you get much better code, and it just works better, and you find your problems at compile time and not runtime. The open connection method has a connection string that connects to the server on the local machine. I'm using the Northwind database and a trusted connection, and I set a connection timeout to 10. Like the command says, there should be error handling here. I don't have error handling there because I know it's correct and I don't want to make this code too complicated. Now, what I'm doing with the connection, I'm going to create a command, select star from customers with the connection object, call what is called a method execute reader. This returns a read-only, forward-only cursor to the results, and I'm creating what's called a data table object. The data table object is a .NET container which can contain results from one select statement. It has rows and columns. And then I'm calling data table load and giving it to reader, with, and it will extract first result set from this select statement. What's important to realize is that this is a disconnected result set. So at the end using statement, the connection is dropped and we have data now in memory. But first, let's see if this works. So I have ADO.NET, I have my forms customer. Let's set up the right form. And as you can see, I'm starting empty now. I've painted the grid with three columns, and when I press load, it actually loads the data from the SQL Server. But this is disconnected, so that means when I add something here, the data on the server is unchanged. So when I reselect, you see nothing is saved to the server. This is disconnected. Now, this is not the model that you would work with normally, because normally you would want to also write the changes back to the server. My next sample will show you that. And then things may get a little bit complicated because the way ADO.NET works. Okay, let's have a look at something a bit more complicated, which is looks more like code, serious code in an application. I've designed another form, customer orders, in which I will present three elements of the customer as a form. and then a grid of orders and a grid of details. As you can see, we have now more than one binding source. I want to bind the customers fields to a binding source customers. I want to bind the grid for the orders to the binding source orders, and I want to bind the grid for the details to the binding source details. And the binding navigator is bound to the customers. So when I skip to a next customer, I can do it with the buttons on the toolbar, and then we would expect that it will show the orders and details from that customer. Now let's have a look at what the code behind. Okay. I have created a method, again, in the same class where I was selecting the customers before. But now I'm using another class from ADO.NET. It's called the SQL Data Adapter. And this SQL Data Adapter, the first one selects the three columns that I want from customers. It's usually a good idea to limit yourself to the columns that you want. You do not want to fetch memo columns, for example, if you're not displaying them for performance reasons. And I've also created what's called a data set. And this particular data set is going to contain the information for the customers, the orders, and the details. And I'm going to tell the data adapter to fill this data set and call this result customers. So the name of this result inside the data set, which is like a container that will contain three tables, is the table that has the customer information is called customers. My second select statement fetches three columns from the order, and it gets added to this data set with the name orders. And the third one has OD order ID, OD product ID, P product name, and I'm joining the order details table, OD, with the products table, P, on, well, you can read it. It's just fetching the product name, so we have not just the ID, but also the name. I'm going to store this in the order details table. So in this data set, we now have customers, orders, and order details. And to do a proper relation, we now have to tell the data set that customers and orders are linked on the customer ID column. So I'm telling, I'm creating a data relation, which is called customer to order, and it links the customer's customer ID with orders or customer ID. And I'm creating a second relation called called order to the order detail, where I'm linking the orders order ID with the order details order ID. And the result of this method is going to return the data set. So in my sample data library, I'm returning three tables in a set with relations. Now let's have a look at the form. Close some windows here. In my form, in the constructor, I'm now binding the data source for the data grid and the details, so they're already bound. And then when I press the load button, I'm going to fetch the data set. And by the way, the var keyword is something that the people of you who've worked with C# have seen too. It tells the compiler that this is a typed variable and it has to read the type of get customer orders. And I'm not sure if you guys can read the tooltip at home, but it says get customer orders as data set. So the compiler knows that this is a data set. Anyway, I'm assigning this data set to the data source of the customers, which also means that it's bound to the binding navigator. Then I'm assigning the binding source customers to the binding source orders data source, but I'm telling it that it needs to take the customer to order data member. So it knows to fetch the relation and use that to update the orders. And it does something similar for the order details. So the order details has a data source orders, but it takes its member, which is the related details, and fills that. On the bottom, we'll see that I'm binding manually. We could have done this in the designer too, but I'm binding the three controls that show customer information to the form. And to finish off, I'm resizing it. That was necessary because the application was painted with a smaller font, but because of the presentation, the font is much bigger, and this makes sure that all the columns have the proper size. So when I run this code, we start with a blank screen, but now the load button is actually going to fetch the three result sets and return it to the data set, and then I'm binding the data set to the form. And this works, as you can see. And there is a relation, so if I skip here, I can properly see that it works. I can add something. I'm not seeing the product name here. If you want to automatically get the product name, you probably want to replace the product ID and product name columns with a combo box, and then they will look up. For simplicity, I haven't done this. What's important to realize is that this is disconnected. So none of what I'm changing here is sent to the server. So I can delete a row here, and it actually gets deleted. I can even delete complete order, and its order details are gone. But nothing gets saved to the server. So if I load again, everything is back. Actually, now I see an error, which is, I probably have garbage in my, because I've deleted and didn't commit. Anyway, if you want to update, you will have to need this data adapter. And it can become a bit difficult. I won't go into too many details for time's sake, but I have an example of how to do it. We have the same customer orders form with the same way of binding. This is what the code we saw before. But now I also have a save button. And what I'm doing on the save button, since I have a data set, I'm going to, and I have the adapters, which I've stored. I didn't show that before, but I now have a new method called customer orders for update. And this actually not just returns the data set, but also returns the three SQL data adapter objects. Now, why am I doing that? The SQL data adapter is a very powerful class. It allows you to not just to fetch data, but it's like a container for a select statement, an update statement, an insert statement, and a delete statement. And if you do a simple select, like select, in this case, customer ID, company name, contact name from customers, then it knows how to automatically produce a update, insert, and delete statement. The one for orders is the same. Unfortunately, when you do a select like this, where you're joining tables, then it becomes difficult for ADO.NET to figure out what to update, because maybe you added it the product name too, and it doesn't know if you want to actually write a changed product name back to the products table. So to do that, you need to specify what your own update statement, basically. Now, let's first show you the samples running, and then you see what I've done. Okay, this is the sample. I'm loading the data. Let's just change the date. If I save it, you see that it is indeed saved to the database. I can also add a new order. Um, and save it to the database. And you see it's actually written. And I didn't specify an order ID, but the order ID is automatically generated when I save. And I can add products to the thing. And as you can see, the product is indeed translated. Now, there is this, of course, possible that the update fails. I know in this particular database, it's not allowed to have duplicate product IDs. So if you want to do 2 and 3, you need to order 5 at once and not 2 lines with you. So if I do it now, the actual database will give me a failure. So the thing is validated. Unfortunately, what you can do here is I put an option there to tell it to wrap the whole transaction, so all the updates you want transactional. So you can decide to write just all the changes that succeed and ignore the ones that fail, or to actually do everything or nothing. If I change the product ID, of course, then I can save, and then you can see it's there. So what did I do to update? Well, let's have a look at that. Like I saw in my SQL data, I'm returning the adapters here with what we call an out parameter. It's like a parameter by reference. So the code that calls this gets an array of SQL data adapters. This is our syntax for a strongly typed array of data adapters. So in this code, I'm actually returning SQL data adapters, which is a protected field on this class. And I need these adapters later to update. So in my button save, I'm now calling, depending on the flag checked or not, either update data with transaction or update data. Let's have a look at the one without transaction. Okay, I know that in my sample, I'm not updating customers because all the fields are read-only. So in this particular code, I'm actually ignoring the first adapter. But for completeness, I've included that. And then, since we were working disconnected, to update, we need to have a new connection. So that's why this code starts with begin using open connection. And I'm now assigning the connection to the select command. So the adapter now is connected again. And I'm calling a method inside this particular code, which is called get generate commands. And it's really a simple method. It says we're using another object from ADO.NET, in this case from the SQL database, is called SQL command builder. And this will automatically take the adapter that has a select statement and generate an update, insert, and delete statement. Now let's run this in the debugger and see what happens. Unfortunately, let's go back to where I was. For the orders data adapter, this works, so we can call them update. But for the detail adapter, you cannot automatically generate it. I mentioned that before. And in this case, I actually have to create SQL myself. So I have to tell it to generate an update statement, an insert statement, or a delete statement. And I have to set up the parameters. And I have separate methods because I have to set up the parameters for both the update, insert, and delete. So I'm actually adding parameters for each of these in the detail. And it says, okay, I have a order ID, product ID, unit, price, and quantity. And in case of a update or delete, we need to have all information too. So we need to specify that it is a parameter that actually takes the value from how it was, how it's now, or the value how it was before. And in my statements, I've named the original underscore. And the add parameter here says that it wants to have what's called the row version original, or if I do not specify old, it's going to return the row version current. It's a bit complicated, But what we do is we actually tell ADL.NET each row in the table has a original value and a current value, and we tell it that for the update where clause it needs to include the original values, and for the update or the delete condition it needs to actually use the new value. And so this is kind of complicated, but the result is that it works. Let's see what happens here too. So run the code. This let once change over here, and let's change the product to 29. And now we're in the save command. And we see that we get a data adapter, and the data adapter has a select command, has an empty update command, an empty insert command, and an empty delete command. The select command has a statement select customer ID, order date from orders. Now, the builder will now take care of creating the right statements. So you can see that the update command now has update orders. Let's view this. Set customer ID is, etc. And it uses the same name since same name principle that we saw in the code that I've written manually. So it takes original customer ID, original order ID, and order date. And it also has a collection of parameters. And you see the actual parameters. And if you would look here, you would probably see that they have the source version original, the ones that are named original, and the other one have the source version current. So parameters are either linked to the current value or the original value. And something similar happens for the details adapter. And in the details, now I'm actually generating all these things that would be done before on the fly, and I'm calling update, and it works. So it is a bit complicated. And usually when you do this in combination with ADL.NET, people use OR mappers, OR, which is like a tool that generates source code for you, which takes care of this basically, and it generates stored procedures. And if you use stored procedures, you can just also hook up the stored procedures for update, insert, and delete. It is a bit out of scope of this session because it's not really about the data binding, but it's how about to write things back. But at least I want to give you an idea. The use transaction flag is actually using the same code that we saw before, but it actually sets up a transaction and it sets up a try-catch handler. And if the transaction is set, it's going to roll back. And if we get to the last line before the catch statement, it's actually going to commit it. So this is going to either write all the changes or no changes at all. Good. So far, we saw ADO.NET and in-memory result sets. Now, since you guys are all FoxPro developers and you've all grown up with DBFs, I think it's time to now actually do a project that shows some DBF data. If you go to the project properties in Visual Studio and go to the general page, you will see that now the dialect, I shouldn't change it, is FoxPro. So this actually creates an application that has FoxPro. And if you do that, you will also have to add references to X-Sharp runtime assemblies. The previous ones didn't have these references. The basic idea is that there's a visual FoxPro layer. We also have a XBase Reserved layer and a visual object layer. We have some core code some runtime functions. Runtime contains stuff like left and right, etc. But it also contains support for arrays, dates, you name it. I have a form which doesn't look too different from the form that we saw before when we listed a group of objects that were declared in code. And on this form, we now start to see what we call normal FoxPro code. So we set up the binding source again, but now, and this is what you want to change if you do it at home, we're setting up a customer's table with a simple use statement. So this opens a cursor. And what I'm doing in the next line, I'm creating an object which comes from the X-Sharp runtime. And if you read the comment, it's probably too small, but it says this creates a DB data source object attached to the current work area. In other words, this creates something that .NET recognizes and can be used as a data source, but it's attached to the current work area. The important thing is that this means that it's not detached like we saw before, but it's actually writing live to the DBF. Now, let's just try this. Okay, I've selected it already. Over here now, we see an auto-generated grid. Oh, come on, progress. And we also see that for some reason, I know why, we've added a column with recno and deleted. So these are exposed as properties. So in your code, if you use DB data source for each row in the DB source, which is like which we call is a DB record, it returns a record number and a deleted flag. So we can toggle the deleted flag here. No, come on. I can't. Well, this is apparently a bug. This should be able to toggle, but it doesn't work, unfortunately. But I can also edit the company name. So if come on, make it a bit wider. If I change this to Alfred Futterkiss to 1, and I close the form and run it again, you will not be surprised since I said that it was attached and not detached. This is actually written to disk. So this starts to look like a normal Visual Fox Pro browser, right? Everything is attached to the DBF. Now, if you do not want to show the deleted flag or recno, you can still disable that. There's a property on the data source object that controls that. And as you expect, you see these are now hidden from the browse view. Of course, if you would have designed the browse view and created your own columns, then you wouldn't have to hide them because it would then only show you the columns that you've painted. So what you see here is that with X-Sharp, you can use familiar command syntax like set default to, use, close over here in the form closing because we want to close it over here. What's important to realize is that I'm using a normal Windows Forms form over here. So this form doesn't have a data context like you used in FoxPro. So we need to manually manage the lifetime of the cursor. We will come with a special Visual Fox Pro version of the form class in our runtime that actually takes care of that. But for now, you need to open it in the constructor and close it when the form is closing. Something else that you may want to know is, okay, what about SQL access? Is that supported the way we use it too? And of course, the answer to that is yes. My next example, and then I'm going to do a short break for questions. My next example is about doing SQL. Now, you see no difference on this form in the Painter, we have a binding source, a binding navigator, and a grid view. For simplicity, I kept it the same. But over here now, we see code that may look familiar to you from the FoxProp world. We see a string connect, and this uses the ODBC connection. So I'm telling it to use the SQL Server ODBC connection, ODBC driver, I should call it, with the local server, Northwind database, trusted connection is true. And then I'm not showing you just the customers, but I'm doing a SQL exec on a view. And this view, I'm not sure who designed it, but the view has spaces in its name. So we use brackets to delimit the name, select star from customer and suppliers by city. It's not a naming convention that I would recommend, but it works. And again, this opens a cursor. And as you can see in my exec, I've named it customers. So the cursor is named, but I'm using again the DB data source. So we have direct connection to this cursor with the name customers. And as you can see, we have other columns now because I've fetched companies from the customer and suppliers table, and we see the relationship is either customers or suppliers. So yes, you can use SQL exec and select data, fetch it in a cursor, and by using DB data source, you can directly bind it to a grid. But if I designed a form view, I could use the same binding that we saw before. One thing that it's not related to binding, but I'd like to show, is this is new. In X-Sharp, we have, of course, added support for ODBC connection. And that's why we needed to specify the driver here. All we need is to set, give it the data source name that we create on the computer's workstation before. However, we also support other ADO.NET providers. And we've added a function to the runtime, which is not, does not exist in FoxPro, and it tells us which provider to use, which factory in this case to use. And I'm telling it to use SQL Server. This means that the connects, the string that I have to pass here, is now no longer an ODBC connect string, but it's the same connect string that we saw before in the ADO.NET example, where I was using the SQL classes from ADO.NET. And it will not surprise you that in the background, this uses the same classes. So I'm using a SQL string connect. I'm telling it it's not shared. And I'm using SQL exec. And you will see no differences, except that if you would do this with a large result set, you would actually see that the ODBC one is slower than the one that uses the SQL provider directly, because there's one layer of code in between. ODBC driver talks in the backend through the SQL server, and the SQL provider just has one layer of API less. So yes, you can connect SQL data to your forms by using the same. Okay, I have a short break now. If anyone has a question about this, please ask now. Otherwise, I'll continue with WPF.
Hi, Robert. We have one question, which is, do the curly braces, like SQL adapter curly brace, indicate that, indicate that a new object is being created of the specified class or type?
Yeah, exactly. The curly braces is the X-Sharp syntax that we inherited from Visual Objects in Vulkan to create an object. Actually, it's not mandatory to do that. So where I create a curly, let's go to the first sample. Just to show you that I'm not lying. So the startup object. When I'm informed correctly, this is what you do in FoxPro, if I'm informed correctly, but we'll see in a minute if it doesn't work. No. I've forgotten. Oh, no, this isn't work. This is not in this sample because this is core dialect. Yeah, it's a bit difficult. Yeah, we do support create object, but you have to have the FoxPro dialect enabled. But there's a big difference. If you would do create object like I did, then the compiler has no idea if the customer's object actually exists. It cannot validate that because this string, actually create object is just a function, and the string could have any meaning. And you could, for example, also have dynamically loaded an assembly where the customer is available, and at compile time, it doesn't know that. So there's no checking. With the customer curly braces, there's compile time checking. And if I make a typo here, it will actually not compile because it says I cannot find customers one. So this ensures that the type customers exists at compile time, and the code it generates is better. It's create object, if we would do it in the FoxPro syntax, returns something that is an object, and it would work, but then at runtime, it would check, because this is declared as customers, it would check if it actually is a valid object of customers, and if not, it would generate a runtime error, which of course you would try to avoid. Okay, since there was one error, one question only, I'm going to continue with the presentation because there's so much that I want to show you guys. So we looked at Windows Forms. Now I have a look at WPF. And when I look at WPF, I'm doing it briefly. I know that Eric Sellier is doing a session about X-Sharp, and he has a beautiful example of a to-do explorer written in WPF. So, and also, people that know me in the VO Vulkan community know that my nickname is Mr. Data, and my nickname is not Mr. UI. So I'm not really good in creating nice UIs. But I do want to show you how to do, let's set this a bit bigger. So actually I've created a form here, and in WPF, you design the form with what's called XAML. You may or you may not like it. It is the way it is. The idea originally was that as a developer, you would code the logic, you would give your project to a person good in UI, and he would just change the XAML and would make your app look good. I don't think people do that. I think most people, most developers also do the UI. Now, you can argue whether that's a good idea or not. I can tell you, don't let me do the UI. I'm not good in that. Anyway, this one uses a data grid, and there's just one data grid in the window. And my form has a code behind. And what I'm doing here is I'm linking the same customers collection that we saw before as item source on the grid and show if that works or not. So let's do it. And as you can see, this indeed works. Again, the grid has looked at the customer's collection, and for each row in this collection, it figured out the type of each row, figured out the public properties, and for example, it figured out that full name is read-only because there's only a getter and not a setter, and first name can be edited. So let's do Donald again. But now you see a difference with what we saw in Windows Forms. In WPF, if you we were not using a binding source that we saw before. We were directly linking to the customer's object. WPF doesn't use binding sources, but because it doesn't, the automatic propagation of the change in the first name column, which needs to update the value of the full name, isn't happening. In a WPF world, the controls expect that the objects that are shown implement a certain logic, a certain interface. Let's have a look at how to solve this and what I've done to do that. So I've created a collection called Customers Observable. And this Customer Observable collection is no longer a list, but it's an observable collection. That's don't ask me why. This is a collection that's often used with a WPF application. This collection supports notifying the consumer about new rows, deleted rows, etc. In Windows Forms, the binding source object took care of that. I've also added a new customer object. It's called Customers Observable. And before, we had a simple object with three properties and a calculator. One of them is calculated. As you can see now, this gets a bit more complicated. To begin with, the Customer Observable implements a certain interface that WPF expects. It expects objects that it wants to talk to implement what's called iNotify property change. And iNotify property change is declared in the component model namespace. And it tells the compiler that this customer observable object needs to implement a certain method. And the method that it expects is actually, it doesn't implement a method, but it needs to expose a property changed event. And when the object actually exposes this property changed event, then in this the example that we show was a grid, then the grid will register itself and says, okay, object, please let me know when something has changed. Now, and to do that, we cannot do this automatically generated properties that we saw before, the auto properties, but we actually have to code the property. So we see that the last name property returns a field, last name, and the setter says, okay, when the value has changed, value is a implicit parameter of the setter. So each time you set this, the last name, you get a local variable called value, and this has the new last name. When its last name is different, so when it's not the same, we're going to assign it, and we're going to call on property changed last name. But since we know that this also affects the full name, we're going to also call on property changed full name. And I'm doing something similar for the first name. And on property changed is a private method that I've written here, which takes the name. And I've given it a default. This is a syntax for a default parameter. I've typed the parameter. This is also new in X-Sharp. The iNotify property change expects a method that has a string parameter and a void, which is a nothing return value. So we have to declare the method just like that. And it also expects, actually, this is not true. This is my own method. But the property changed event expects to receive a property changed event args object. And this event args object expects to get the name of the property as a string. So what I'm doing here is I'm creating a changed event args, giving it a name, last name, first name, full name. And this syntax, those of you who have coded C# may be aware of that. It says when property changed is not null. In other words, when someone has registered to be notified about property changes, Then we're going to invoke the event, so we're going to call the event and pass itself, which is the current object, and the event arc, so it is which name was changed. Now we do not see the other side of this. Inside the grid is actually going to receive this event and then know which column was changed. It sounds complicated, and to be honest, this is complicated. But there's a good the good thing is that you do not have to write this code usually, because usually people use frameworks to generate this code, or they mark the type with a certain attribute, which again is a bit out of the scope of the session, but there is a way to specify that properties have that types have special properties with what we call an attribute, and you can have tools that look for this attribute and then generate this boilerplate code, because this is boilerplate code. You see, this is if you would have more than two properties, they would all have the same kind of code. If the name is changed, assign it, call on property changed, and this you probably need to do something special, because this you need to know that full name is dependent. Anyway, a long story. If I set the item source for this grid to custom observable, then you see nothing visual. But in the background, let's do Donald again. You see actually that Donald was changed and that the full name was also calculated. And if you would look in the debugger, which is probably nice, I think the debugger in Visual Studio is absolutely great. I was changing a first name, though let's set a breakpoint here. Takes a while to start. Oh, actually, it is coming here. It's true. I'm assigning the, when I'm constructing the collection, I'm assigning four forgeons, first names. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is what we expect, of course. And now if I change this to Donald, I will actually see that the field first name is now Donald. So is Don. The new value is Donald. I'm going to call onProperty changed. And this is now going to call the property changed event handler. We do not see what's happening because this is code inside WPF that we're calling. But anyway, it got notified. And we're notifying it about the full name too. And it has updated the screen. So as you can see, writing the property triggers the setter and will, in this case, call on notify property changed. We do support, like I said in the start slide, also the define syntax for classes. And we also support assign and access method, just like FoxPro does. So if you would have declared your class with the define class syntax and have a assign and access method, you could also in the assign method write similar code. The only difference is that the event has to be declared this way and has to have the proper signature. So it has to be a property changed event handler to be recognized by the WPF grid to work with. So it's probably a bit difficult to use the Visual Fox Pro defined class syntax unless we also start adding new stuff to the syntax, which I must confess we haven't. So we do not support creating event handlers and implementing interfaces for the defined class syntax. The defined class syntax is there so you can take your old code and get it to compile. Okay. Yeah, the if you look at the paper, and you could probably see that I didn't do a form view for WPF. That is possible, absolutely. One thing that's missing in WPF, I'm not sure why, but there's no binding navigator. So this nice toolbar with skip buttons and a record number column, which you can type, doesn't exist. However, third parties have created that. For example, I found a Telegrid navigator control on the Telegrid website. It's just a piece of source code that you can download and use in your app, and it works great. The paper has an image where I've used that, but I have not included it here because I'm not completely sure about the copyright of that, and I didn't want to send it and then break any copyright things. But there are samples available of navigators, and to my opinion, if you do a form, you need some kind of navigator. Of course, you could paint skip buttons and respond to that too. That's also possible. Let's have a look at binding a WPF grid again, but now to a DBF data source. So what I've done, I'm not sure why the font form is so small, but what I've done, I've created a window now with the data grid again. I've changed something here. This is the recommended way of doing it. I've set the item source to binding. This is the syntax that says to WPF, whatever this particular component needs to bind to what's the data source of the window. So the grid binds to the data source of the window. And for the grid, I've said that the columns, in this case, which are designs, need to be bound to the binding, which is the data source of the form, and then the column with the name, custom ID, company name, and contact name. And what's the command above is important. Note that the column names have to be in lowercase. To bind the form, we're using again this DB data source. And since WPF is case sensitive, we have created DB data source in such a way that it always exposes columns in lowercase, so you know what you can expect. And as you can see, this was the truth for the Windows forms before too, where our RDD, our driver for DBFs, knows to get the long column name. So if you look at the DBF itself, the column name is company num without the E. But this table is part of a dictionary. And in the dictionary, it says that the long full column name is company name. So we support company name as column name. So we do support reading the database container and getting the name from there. So let's run this. So now I am reading a WPF grid. And remember that we've changed Alfred's name in the previous example. As you can see, the DBF was still changed. And now we're going to change the contact to Robert Anderson. And if I run it again, you will see that by filling the WPF grid with a DB data source, we've actually have a attached result set, and the grid shows live data. So if someone else was updating the same DBF when it's on a shared drive, we would see their changes too. So yeah, I think this is pretty cool. So it's cool in the sense of WPF that it works, that we actually bind the data to the grid, but also that you can actually get your DBF data and show it live on the WPF window. Now, what I didn't mention with Windows Forms, but what I do want to show is I have a similar window here with similar code, but a bit different. I'm using something else now, which also comes from the XSharp runtime, which is called DB Data Table. And what this does is this takes the current cursor and creates a .NET data table on top of the cursor and loads the complete cursor in memory. So DB Data Table gives you the complete result set of the customers and stores it in the table. And that's why you can see in this sample, I'm using it, and I could have done close, but I'm using use without, because use without table name will close the cursor too. And it's actually disconnected now. And there's a good thing and a bad thing, but it's the way .NET works. So when I run the sample, you will see it is reading the information from the DBF because Maria is now called Robert. But if I close the form and I run it again, it will still be Robert because it's disconnected. However, it would be nice if you work disconnected that you can save the data. And as you can see, this form has a save button. So what we have done is we've built in a mechanism in the XSharp runtime. If you later in the time use the same cursor again, so use the same customers, and call DB table save, it's going to look into the data table and fetch the rows that were added, deleted, or updated. The .NET data table, which is behind this forms, keeps track of the changes. And then we will use the record numbers that we've stored for each row that we saw in one of the examples before for the DB data source, but this has the same. And we know which record to go to and to update. Now, of course, you could argue that the record could have been changed by someone else, and we need to implement the error handling, and that's true. For simplicity, now I'm not doing that, but we did build that in. So I can change Maria back and then save it. And if I run the sample again, you can see that Maria is again the contact person of the particular customer. So why do I do it? I just want to give you an idea that we support both connected result sets with the DB data source, and we support disconnected. What we do not support at this moment is the data, special objects that you guys have that have cursors just for the form and that closes all the cursors on the form. We will come with that in one of our next builds, and we will come with a special forms object that has support for this. Finally, many people in C# world are using Entity Framework. You may have heard of it. I've created an Entity Framework library in this project, which actually uses again the same database. And this is a model of tables that I've imported from the SQL Server. So it has the products and the supplies, etc. And when you use Entity Framework, it actually generates source code that creates classes with the properties of each of the columns. And you can extend this and put logic in there, and etc. But this is work. I must be honest, this does not, creating this kind of code is not available yet in XSharp. But since we can mix XSharp with C# and VB, there's no problem at all. In this case, I created this particular assembly with or library with C#, and I have a sample here which has a reference to the Entity Framework data source. And in my sample here now, I'm creating a Northwind entities object, which is actually the wrapper around entity framework around all the objects. And when I set the data context now to the context, which is like the database entities, and then the customer's collection, then I can actually link the WPF form to SQL Server using entity framework. So this is no longer the DBF. And when I close the form, I'm going to call save changes on the context. If you save changes, then automatically takes care of saving the changes to the SQL backend. So Maria is now again called Robert, but this was the Maria in SQL, not the Maria in the DBF. So in WPF, we often use a combination with entity framework, because entity framework automatically generates code, which also takes care of notify property change and stuff like that. And the nice thing about entity framework is that it also takes care of, if you call its method save changes, to do the changes on the form. And if you use entity framework, it's often used in combination with LINQ, language integrated natural query. And what I would like to show you here is, let's do it like that, that we actually support LINQ in XSharp 2. So now I have the customers, and the customer collection in the entity framework has an orders object on each customer. And when I would like to show just the customer without orders, you could do something like this. It says from C in customer. So this says the customer's collection returns a C object for each row, and then fetch only the rows where the orders count is zero. It's a bit strange syntax. We followed the C# rules for LINQ, but I think the nice thing is that it just works. So when I run the sample, now I actually see that we just get the two customers who haven't ordered from us yet. Now you can imagine that you combine it with all kinds of things, but also this is editable. So if you do context save changes, and I've saved, let's prove it. Oh no, it's not editable. WPF has detected that this is a read-only result set. And now I managed to crash my demo. This is great. That always happens. Anyway, this was basically the last thing I wanted to show. We can bind WPF to collections of data, and the collections can come out of your code. The collection can be collections created on top of DBF or on top of ADO.NET, and it can also be a collection, did I run this in debug mode? No, I didn't. I have to kill the sample. Good. Okay. So you can also connect to collections returned from entity framework. In this particular sample, I didn't paint my columns and I didn't control the UI. Normally, of course, you would do that. And I do recommend look at Eric Stelly's session where he does demo that. Okay. To finish off my session, let's go back. Good. What I tried to show and what I hope you've seen is the basics of data binding. Windows Forms needs a special binding source object. WPF doesn't use that, but it requires the objects to implement iNotify property changed. And we either do that manually, or, for example, what I didn't mention, but DB data source actually implements iNotify property changed. So that's why it binds. We've seen how you can bind DBF data to forms in WPF, and you can see that XSharp actually works, and it looks a lot like Foxborough. Okay, this was it. Don't forget to fill out your evaluation, but I have one more thing. Good. XSharp, this is my commercial slide, basically. XSharp is a product funded by subscribers. So we couldn't done XSharp when nobody had trusted us. So we have customers who says, we trust you guys, and they understand that we need funding to do the development, and we have what we call subscriptions to the Friends of XSharp program, FOX, pun intended. The subscription is €9.99 per year. We do have volume licenses, so if you want more, we have discounts. But the more important one is, if you order now, use the coupon code VFF2020, which is valid until November 30, you will get a 35% discount on your first year of subscription. And we do have a number of Visual Fox Pro subscribers at the moment, but important for you guys is that we set the priorities for development based on what our customers want. If we have many Fox Pro developers who want to have more Fox Pro support in XSharp, guess what? You'll get it. But right now, I must be honest, the majority of our subscribers is not Fox Pro. So that's why Fox Pro may not get as much attention as would have been the case if we had more Fox Pro subscribers. So don't hesitate. Join our program, subscribe. You do not have to join the program to work with XSharp. It's a free download. Go to www.xsharp.info, register a user account, and you can download it for free. But if you think it's worth doing, then subscribe and download it. XSharp is fully open source. There are links to the GitHub repositories where you can find the source to both the compiler and the runtime. So if you have a problem, you can look in the source and help us fix it. Thanks for your attention. I think I had planned to do an hour and a half, and I'm on the spot, hour and a half. If you have any questions, please let me know.